great to know that you people are really enjoying. And I'm so glad that I have been able to initiate something meaningful, because during this pandemic, I felt that it is really important to spread the positivity, and at the same time, we should all keep ourselves engaged, which is more important. And if we are really doing some kind of, fruitful activity, maybe some kind of discussion and knowledge sharing, it will also enhance our personality, our knowledge, and maybe our skills. So that is the prime reason of doing this online knowledge forum. And primarily, I also wanted to help the society by doing some kind of knowledge sharing, which I believe is important. So today our topic is very interesting. We have a topic, something which is a burning issue right now, because we all know that with the ongoing pandemic, the education system has changed dramatically. And globally, people are talking about how to find an alternative to the conventional education. And that is why we have seen the rise of electronic learning or online education. So e-learning is the priority right now. And with this pandemic, we can see that 1.2 million, or I can say 1.3 million, 1.38 million, as per the, the Hewitt research, students are out of school. So 1.3 million students are out of school globally. So these students are basically like not able to go to the classroom. They basically don't have any other alternatives apart from online education. Now today what we are going to discuss, like how exactly this online education is making sense, because what we can understand as per the UNICEF data, that 72 million people are basically out of school who are of the primary education. And in a country like India, where the digital divide is widening the gap, where most of the people are hardly able to afford this, the devices through which they can get the online education. That is also one of the concerns we'll discuss today. But before we really come to all these points, today I would like to share the objectives which I have already planned and what exactly we'll do. Because the purpose of this discussion is that we will try to bring in some facts which are unknown to us. At the same time, we will also try to understand that how exactly we can overcome the challenge, right? We'll also try to understand that what exactly the remedies. So all these things we are going to discuss today. So hi Devdutt, welcome to the session. You are not late. We are basically discussing that what exactly are the objectives today. So I'm going to quickly share the screen. Here I've got a small presentation for you where I'm basically going to show that how exactly we are going to work out this thing today. My screen is visible to all?
Yes, it is visible, sir.
Yeah, it's fine. Visible. Can you zoom it?
Yes, I will. Is it visible now?
Yeah, it's visible. All right.
So here, as you can see, the impact of online education on children and parents. So we are going to discuss, this is basically our topic today, and then we are going to pass on to the next topic. Is it visible to all?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So the first point which we are going to discuss is, what are the scopes of online education in the present scenario? Because if you see, in the present scenario, we basically are really trying to cope up with this new change or the new advent of digital education. Because most of the cases we have seen that the parents are not really well trained. They are really finding it difficult to cope up. The students are finding it difficult to cope up. And in many places, people are really not able to adapt with this new change. And some already have adapted well. So how exactly we can see the scope of this online education, and what is the present scenario and how much it is relevant? Then we are going to understand how online education is an alternative of the traditional education today. Then we are going to see that what are the advantages and disadvantages, because of course there are different opinions on this. So we are also going to delve deeper into this part. And finally, we'll understand how much this new method on imparting education is effective. And we'll also see, will it stay in the coming times? Because many of us have questioned that in the coming time, whether the online education is going to stay. Because if you see, in till 2019, we have seen there is a big demand of online education. And it is like already predicted by 2025, this online education will be a $350 billion market. So you can understand there is an optimum scope of growth. So it is going to be the future. So, and what are the challenges the children and parents are facing? That is, in fact, one of the core agenda of our session today, that we are going to understand what exactly are the do's and don'ts for the children and parents and how to really adapt it well so that we can cope up well with this new change. Of course, we are going to discuss how to overcome this learning of online education, and we'll also discuss briefly about learning method. So now I'm going to show you something. Can you see that? Are the squares inside the blue and yellow squares all the same color?
Yes.
This structure is visible to all?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. So what exactly do you think is the answer? Are the squares inside the blue and yellow squares all the same color? Is it visible to all of you? Is it visible to all?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is one. So what do you think? What is the answer?
These are the tools for education or online education.
See, the reason I'm showing you is basically how our brain reacts. So it is a visual thing which you are saying it right now. So you can see that these are blue and yellow squares, all of the same color or of different color. It's a kind of a mental test for all my viewers. So how many of you think the squares are all of the same color? All of you, or you differ?
It's a different.
Different color?
Different color.
Yeah, it's a different color, no? Yellow,
yes.
Blue and pink.
Okay. Any other answer?
Different.
That is pink and red. I can view pink and red.
Okay. Fine. Let's go to the next question. I'll give you the answer of all these questions. Are the horizontal lines straight or crooked? So you can see some horizontal lines on the screen. So now you have to tell me, are they straight or crooked? I mean, like, they're not straight, they're irregular, they're crooked, or they're straight lines? Is it visible to all?
You are asking for the three circles or only into the blue circle you are asking? These lines?
I'm saying the straight line.
Which there are three circles actually.
Black, and maybe it is coming in your screen as blue, but it is black, white and black.
Sir, you are asking from blue circle, middle circle?
Yeah, straight lines. Can you see the straight lines on the screen?
No.
No, sir. Actually, I think only the first screen we are seeing.
Uh-huh.
No, actually, there are three circles. In the center circle, there are.
All right. So we are actually trying to figure out. We have seen. Hi, Mr. Mukesh. Welcome. All right. So we have been trying to understand that how exactly our brain works. So I have shown you like a square where there are different colors, and at the same time, I was trying to explain that how exactly we can identify things. So it has been seen our brain always understand things better when we see patterns, right?
Exactly, sure.
So it has been tested that the process of learning is more effective when we show patterns and there are activities which are related to the patterns and how it addresses to the cognitive skills. Now, what are cognitive skills? Cognitive skills are basically the skill to remember, to memorize, and to do certain activities which are going in our, maybe the behavior in our knowledge. Now, generally, it has been seen that whenever children or the adults, whenever we do such activities more, it always infuses our cognitive skills more actively. Okay. So this is just a small test. So with this small test, what we understand that we are able to get more involved when something is being shown to us, some patterns are being shown to us. So this is definitely a test which actually tells you that how online education is effective in the current scenario. But at the same time, we have to understand that today, when we are talking about this online education, how much we are really in a position to integrate information technology with the present traditional mode of teaching. Because what we find that today, when we are talking about online education, in most of the homes, people does not have the right, maybe the device, they don't have the proper infrastructure. Many of the teaching institution does not have the proper training. It has been seen that whenever there is a major world event or there is a major, you can say some incidences, it always have proved to be the inflection point of a new innovation. So maybe if you go back in the time of Industrial Revolution, that time in America, when there was a lot of crisis going on and people are talking about how to change the education to ensure that we get people who are industry ready and to make people get some kind of knowledge through which they can get some skills which will be available for earning money. And then suddenly there was a movement of .com or the electronic world, the internet. And then we have seen there was a movement of lot of knowledge. People are trying to adapt themselves. And then finally we see that there was a slowdown in the market, even IT fell down after a certain time, and then again it rises up. Similarly, this pandemic is definitely a disaster, but it's also an opportunity. So we have to understand that this particular maybe is an untimely challenge for us, for the mankind, but this has definitely opened a door of opportunity for us. So we have to identify that opportunity. That how exactly this online education has created an opportunity for us, that is also we're going to discuss today. So how we are going to take this opportunity, but for that we should realize that the world was not prepared. So none of the educational institutions, none of the teachers, none of the students are really prepared to face this challenge or to adapt with this challenge. So we didn't even know that we have to go for this online meeting. We didn't even know that all our students have to sit with their tablets or laptops or computers. And how many parents are really in a position to afford a laptop or a tablet or any other handheld device for the children? Because it has been seen the parents are facing the maximum problem at home. You will see that average middle class hardly have one or two smartphones at home. If you basically find that suddenly this change has come, then you have to dedicate or sacrifice your phone for your children. So during that time when the class will go on, even if your phone comes, you have to sacrifice them. Or maybe you have other equipment to sacrifice because you have no other alternative. So that is one of the biggest challenge. Secondly, when we are talking about online education, we really have not trained none of the parents or the teachers that how to give them a structured environment. Because you see, when a child goes to a school or when anyone goes to any institution, we always get motivated by the visual clue. So when you are actually asking the child to sit at home and do the study, the environment is going to matter a lot, especially for the small kids. So when they basically see in their surrounding that somebody is walking around, mom is going with the food, your small brother is playing around you, automatically you are distracted. And especially for the kids, it is very difficult. So are we doing enough to give them a structured environment? Because we have to replicate the physical environment around them. Unless we do that, the success of online education is still incomplete. In the other hand, if you talk about the teachers are also not in a position to get a proper training because it was all of a sudden. So the schools, the institutions, they gave a very short notice and said that you have to start online. So even many of the teachers doesn't even know that how to use these online applications. So they are struggling, they are searching, and they're trying to learn from their own initiative, which I really appreciate. But are we still in a position to adapt this challenge, and what exactly we should do, and what are the responsibilities of the parents? What exactly the parents must do to ensure that their child gets the education properly? So we are going to understand that. So if we talk about the parents today, there are normally five challenges the parents are having. The first challenge, the parents have to decide that how to engage their child for the online education and not doing any other activity on internet. Because when you are saying that your child will be having a smartphone or a laptop or any other device with internet, can you ensure that your child is only engaged in online education and not in any other thing? So that is something very important. So you have to be very much focused on that, how you are engaging your child only for the online education and not other any other activity on internet, which could be Facebook, which could be social sites, which could be any other thing which is not relevant for the student. Secondly, you have to understand that how you are basically balancing with your household activity or household responsibility and the education of the child. Because many a time it has been seen that maybe the online classes are going on, you are shouting with your spouse or you are busy talking with your maid. So automatically the mind of the child is getting distracted, or maybe you are not giving enough room or enough space to the child so that the child can really concentrate on that education. So you have to maintain a proper balance between your household responsibilities and the classes. So if you really cannot do that, your child will not be getting a proper education right now. Third thing, many parents are actually doing working from their home. Many parents are working from their home during this time of pandemic. Like your child, you are also having your online office work. So you have to understand that how exactly you are encouraging your child. At the same time, you are also prioritizing your work so that it does not conflict with your child's education. Are you able to give enough time to your child? Because it may happen that you are so much engrossed, you're so much busy with your work that you really don't have the time to help your child to get connected for the online class. So this is one, right? And the next thing which I'm going to tell you is really very important. When this online education is going on, are we really acknowledging the teachers? Are we really taking the feedback? Because feedback is very important. You have to know that whether your student is really getting the things properly or not. It may happen that for some people, online education is very effective. For others, it may not be. But it has been seen that 25 to 40% the retention level is higher on online education. People can remember very well. And the reason is that when you are going to a class, you hardly can remember 8 to 10% of the things. And probably it is because they are not having so much of physical exhaustion. They are not having so much of visual distraction. So possibly online education is a better option. But taking feedback, every day when you are seeing your student or your child is going through an online education, the parents must talk, either the dad or the mom, so that they can understand that they are really getting what exactly is being explained in the online classes. And also, the fifth thing is how you follow up the task. Because this day, it has been seen that there is an extreme pressure even in the online classes. Because the video tutorial classes or online activities are going on. Teachers are giving a lot of activities. But how many of us are really taking time to see that whether our children or our, you know, the peoples, they are really finding the time to do that task. We are thinking they have done the online classes, finished, our responsibility gone. No, you have to see that the tasks which are given, they are really following that, because you have to remember, they also will be assessed online now. So you will not have those online, you know, you will find that those days are gone when people have to go in class and give examination, because ICSC and CBSE are already talking about online tests this year. So if this kind of thing is going to come up, we have to prepare ourselves for that. Mentally, we should be ready. Our students should be ready to face this challenge. All right? So these are basically the challenges which the parents have, and they have to understand that how they can cope up their children for this new change. So it really is a bigger responsibility for the parents. Now, coming down to the students, you have to understand very, because if I can see that two small kids are watching, who basically will be benefited with this session. So those who are not watching, you can pass on this knowledge to them, especially when the children are really using the tablet or any other device, laptop, smartphone. You have to ensure that you should spend maximum time only with your online classes and not anything else. Because you have to understand, this is a moment of priority where you have to take this, you know, responsibility on your shoulder, that you have to really understand that this is the best alternative right now for you. Instead of going outside, you are staying indoor in your home, safe within the comfort of your home where you are getting the education. So if you are basically spending the maximum time on your education, I think that is the best option for you, where you don't have to make any other physical exhaustion or you have to waste your time commuting to the school. So what you should do first thing, every day when you start your class, you actually should close your eyes. At least 10 to 20 seconds, you should take deep breathing before you start the classes, because that is very important to get the flow of oxygen in your blood. Because what happens when you constantly keep watching the screen, there is some kind of harmful ray which can affect your eyes, because there are long hours of class which goes on. And in between the classes, please take a sip of hot water, because right now it is a corona season is going on, children. So please make sure that you keep some hot drink by you, and keep a box of small tiffin box around you. Between the break of classes, please keep munching, so the energy level also goes up, right? Otherwise you'll be dehydrated, you'll be famished, and it may affect your brain. Because if you have empty stomach, you will have problem of acidity, you will have problem of, like, your mind will get distracted. So you think that it is like your session, it's your regime which you have to follow. And moreover, you have to isolate yourself this particular time in a proper way. So I would suggest, I can see that many people, when they come for a training, they come, there is no dress code actually. For online education, there is no dress code. But I will suggest that at least when you come for the classes, come in a particular formal dress. If not the school uniform, or if not a proper uniform, come in a formal dress. Because, you know, when you dress up informally, your minds also start playing formally. Because, you know, learning is actually based on your psychology, physiology, and spiritually. So if you actually connect these three dots, you will see that our mind plays the way we are. So if I basically come casually for the class, I will take the class very casually. So you have to understand that every day when you come for the class, dress properly in the proper way, and then you come. Not necessarily you have to wear the school uniform. And keep always a notepad with you where you can write down and jot all the important points, and make sure that you go through those points after regular intervals. But do not forget to summarize the points and take a pause when basically this teacher is saying something. Because in digital environment, it is not same like the classroom. So you have to understand that how to interact. Correct? So this kind of things, I'm sure you should follow. And I'm sure, like, this kind of sessions which we're doing, is much helpful to you, so that you can already get a warm up for your classes. Already you are doing online classes, I'm sure. So I will be listening to you. But the main challenge which we are facing right now is a technical challenge first, which I would like to say. First of all, the teachers are not trained. That is number one. Second thing is the bandwidth. Because in many places, we are getting complaint, or we keep hearing as an educationist, people are saying, we do not have sufficient bandwidth. Many families are not able to afford the internet packages, or they don't have the proper bandwidth capacity for which the classes are not happening properly. And the third thing is the application itself. The kind of application which we're using is not sometimes supporting in our phone or in our particular OS, right? So we have to, first of all, get ourselves familiar on that. And it's a request to the teachers, those who are really going for the online education, please educate yourself and try to understand a proper structure is very important here right now. Okay, so we will basically give the session to the floor now. I will basically request my viewers to share their point of view on this. You can unmute your mic and then we will discuss. First question to the audience is that how much you think is this online education effective or it's not effective? And my second question to you is like, how many people do you think are really getting benefited by this online education? Because where we know that 60% of the world population is online. So that means 40% population is offline. So in that scenario, when 1.2 million people are outside the classroom, or we never know that the people in the rural areas, whether they are really going to the school because there are no facilities today. So there is a big digital divide. So please give your view. So first is, how much online education is effective and what exactly are your experiences? Please. So we are ready to take on the answers. Option.
I think Mr. Sanjeev has already spoke about the connection, that broadband connection and the internet connectivity.
Okay.
So what the major points, what he has highlighted, that if the connection will be good into the rural areas, so we will able to connect more into the online study and the education part. But actually, I am having a different view, frankly speaking, because I don't know, I don't have any kid right now. But what I would say that when a child will born and he started developing, so in the age of 8, what I understood that they are actually into the phase of the developing their brains. So if they will start along with kind of a online courses, so they will not even understand what is happening in the outside places. Okay, so they would be much more kind of a machinery things. They will not understand the creativity. They will not understand the friends. They will start along with the isolated life. So don't you think that would be a negative impact, which will actually create some negativity into a child's brain? So when we will think of a developed brain, that is okay. Online and e-commerce, we can think of. Even nowadays, when we will apply for a job also, if you see, a lot of people is asking, okay, so have you done any kind of a full-time course or you have done only the online course? So even the weightage part, if you see, everybody is looking for a full-time course, and those who have done a full-time course, maybe they are the superior. So that kind of mentality is also there right now. So that's very challenging to understand what actually we are looking forward. Means the Indians are looking forward. So immediately we can't change the entire thing 360 degree. It will take time. But for a primary education, I would suggest they would start from the means which would be the traditional methodology. I think that would be beneficial, because otherwise what will happen, a person will be isolated and he will never be understand the socialness and the how to mix up with the friends and how to face the challenges. Example, like a hostel life. What is a hostel life? Means a lot of people is actually not aware if they will only understood the online study. So that is my concern.
Yeah, I do agree with your concern, and definitely you are right to a larger extent, because if you talk about building the behavioral skills or the personality of a student or a person, then definitely we have to always give importance to the outdoor activity. But keeping in mind the present situation, we basically cannot take a risk of sending our students to the school. Number two, why we are talking about online education today? Because of the present pandemic situation. We know that this coronavirus has come and that's why many schools are not running. You can say that the corona situation is not same everywhere across the world. In some country, they have already started opening. In South Korea, in Sweden, they have already started opening. In Italy, they have already started opening the school, right? But in maximum number, even in New Zealand also, they have opened the schools. But the problem is today that we have to talk about an alternative. And when we talk about online education, it has come as an alternative to us. And many of us are basically understanding that how much it is feasible and it is practical. And probably that is why we are trying to understand that whether the mode of online education is really effective. And in the coming times, can we think it as a serious alternative for conventional education? But nevertheless, we have to always understand that socializing and going for an outdoor activity is going to develop the cognitive skills of the students, because it has been seen that when a person is in a community, learns more and more faster. And sometimes the knowledge is going to stay for a longer time. But since with the given situation, if you see, the retention is much better when a child is going through an online education, because he or she is finding it easier and more attractive to catch up. But how long it is going to sustain, that is a question. And that is where the parents have to play a bigger role in that. You're getting me? So if you talk about even the, you know, the functioning of the brain is divided into four parts. The frontal cortex, which basically takes the role of decision making, that whether we should do it.
Actually, what I'm trying to say, see, I understood the concern, like in COVID-19, now the situation has changed and means lot of opportunity and lot of things we are looking forward. But what is happening now? Are we really getting benefited for long term on this online course? That is very important to understand. Because definitely, if you see, means lot of students are getting so much mental stress due to these online e-courses. And means parents are also saying several times that how much they would understand. Means if somebody is staying in home for 24 hours, that is very, very difficult for a child, for parents, everyone. They're getting annoyed for different situations. So sometimes I felt it's very much needed some kind of a funful facts or some fun acted e-courses is also important if possible. Otherwise, initial stage, it would be kind of a traditional thing which will help us.
Not audible, sir. Voice is not coming.
Your mute is mute. Is mute.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm basically saying that if others can also give their points on this, what exactly are you think the challenges we are facing? What is your point about digital divide? Because right now we can see that the digital divide is widening the the gap in the society. There is who are having and there are people who are not having. So have and have nots. So there is a big gap, right? So some people are the very privileged one, and some people who are really underprivileged, they have nothing. So there are a lot of people who are going to the government schools. So what exactly we should do so that these students who are going to the government schools who hardly have any infrastructure, where the students have ever seen even a smartphone, because if you go back to the rural village, maybe in some places in Bihar or any other place, maybe any other place, even in West Bengal, you will find that people have hardly got any, you know, smartphones with them. So how exactly we can reach out to them and what exactly the government must do? Maybe we can discuss this thing out, this platform. So what are your ideas?
Yes. One thing, what I want to say is that, as you said, for the rural students, the government is coming up with a new idea that, you know, they will do the class on television. They will televise the class, and they will reach out to the rural area, as they don't have the smartphone or laptop, those things. So the government is thinking that way, that they'll start class on television,
right,
and the students will get the class on television. That is the one initiative taken by Indian government.
Okay.
Yes.
And what exactly are your opinion about the kind of applications which we're using for this online education? How much they're helpful or how much it is difficult? Let us hear from some of the kids. What exactly are their views? Maybe the kids.
As far as I am concerned.
Okay. Yeah. Please, Sanjit, carry on.
So should I continue?
Yeah, please carry on.
So as far as I am using the software or the apps, currently I am using Zoom. Okay. And now the main problem is that right now there is a lot of security problem is coming. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, from the government side, there is a lot of restrictions are happening. And True. Those who have started conducting online classes on this platform, they are facing a big problem. And at the same time, there are few incidents happened in India, in West Bengal and other state, that
Hello. Okay, so this is one of the point which Sanjit has raised. There are a lot of security issues.
No, I have a question.
Yeah, please, Reet. Go ahead.
How can we more concentrate in our online classes?
Okay, that's a good question, Reet. See, when we talk about concentration, we should know that there is a very fine saying by one of the writers that when you talk about concentration, then don't think of proving your concentration, but think of improving your concentration. So how you can improve? Because when we most of the time think of our concentration, we most of the time get a question with ourselves that we have to prove that we are concentrating. But don't think of concentration, because mind is like a monkey. So when you say that I will not do this, the mind will always go in that direction. So you are basically trying to say that I will concentrate, then the mind will not concentrate. It will just do the opposite thing. So it will never happen.
And network issues also occurs.
Yeah. So I will first give answer to your question that how to concentrate. So if you want to concentrate on something, first of all, set your priority that why you want to learn this thing and why you want to listen to this. So if you really get interest into something, automatically your concentration will grow. Second thing is, keep something like, when you generally start the day, we always prepare certain to-do list for ourselves. So maybe the first thing which you keep in your to-do list is what is the most important thing you have to do for that day. So maybe that is your class, or that could be your exercise, that could be some kind of other, activity which you have, maybe your hobby. So based on that, the parents have to play a very big role in planning a timetable for you. So you can take guidance from your dad or your mom, who can prepare a timetable for you. Or you yourself can take an initiative of preparing a timetable, which will definitely help you to set a priority. Secondly, you have to understand that the thing which has to be done at that point of time, that has to be only given. Because, if you divide your daily work into three types, like work A, which is vital, work B, which is essential, and work C, which is desirable. So suppose if you have to take online education, that is going to be the vital exercise for you. Then maybe taking music class, that could be essential for you. And then if you talk about maybe enjoying some fun activities, watching cartoon or playing some video games, that could be a desirable activity for you, right? So when you can categorize your work into vital, essential, and desirable, I'm sure this is also called as VID analysis. Right?
Daily language of schedules.
Yes. So if you can schedule yourself in this way, I'm sure you will be able to concentrate much better. And secondly, when you talk about connectivity, you see right now we are doing this meeting, two times our connectivity were lost. But we have to hold our patience. Like you guys are so passionate and so collaborative that you have every time reconnected me back. So that is also one of the maturity and the patience you have to have. Because we are all trying to cope up with this situation. Right? So I have got one spiritual man with me today, Mr. Mukesh Tiwari. I would request if he can say something about this present situation, that how to get the concentration and how to cope up with this situation. Prabhuji, if you can say something on that. Please unmute your speech. Yeah.
See, the situations that we are going through around the world is not good, right? Everybody is having a lot of problems. But especially for the education, the online classes is the only options we have in our hand, right? The different kinds of education system is having different kinds of benefits and losses, right? But this is a situation where we have to go through these online classes. The questions you were asking for how we can concentrate in these current situations while being in classes. So concentration is not a very simple thing. We cannot control our brain, because even, you know, Arjun also did not, you know, control their brain. So it is very difficult. But even then, we have to, as you rightly said, we have to prioritize our, you know, work. And according to that, we have to, you know, build our internal, you know, concentrations that, no, I have to do this work. I have to do this. I have to do that. According to that, if you decide that, no, I have to be focused on that, it is not very easy. It is very difficult, but we have to go through this. Right? And this current situations, of course, it is not going to be longer. It will be finished. Don't know when, but it is going to finish. It is not going to be longer. So we have to cope up with these situations. Wherever we are, we have to be stay safe and stay healthy. And concentration is required for any work, not even for the study as well. So for concentrations, we have to do, if you want to do more, you know, meditations, that is the only way we can have more concentration. Meditation, everybody knows, I think it is not more details to say about that. We should practice meditation for more concentration.
So I hope you got the answer that meditation is.
I wish to reframe the question for the sake of my daughter. Actually, sure. she was comparing the online classes with the physical classes. She has been acclimatized or tuned to have a classes, the physical classes only. She is very concerned about her studies and all. But now she has started taking classes on online. So comparatively, she is not able to concentrate as much as she is in a class, because she always believes in being in merit. So somehow she is very concerned about her marks and grades. She will I be able to cope up with that pace, because somehow distraction is there, maybe mobile. Although in our home no movement is there, nobody is disturbing. Still she feels some lacuna on online education. I am not able to consider it as much as I can do in the class. So she was asking tips on that, how best I can do on online course.
See, at this point, what is the best tip for you, Reet? You have to understand that because of this present situation, there is no other alternative apart from online education. So we have to switch to that. So in order to get the best out of it, you have to understand that how you can sharpen your cognitive skills. Means how you can learn things from the patterns, how you can learn things from the various, the activities, which could be some online activity, which could be typing, which could be recording, and which could be audio video media, right? Next thing is that how exactly it is going to impact your learning. See, today 60% of the world population is online and they are trying to work in that mode only. So the present situation is telling you that you should sharpen your online skills, which is going to be a demand in the current time. Because most of the people who are the careerists or those who are the educationists, they are suggesting that unless and until you can adapt yourself with a new change, you will become obsolete. So there is no doubt that your education will be equally important in the coming times. And, you know, there is a particular skill called as spatial skills. Now, what is the spatial skills? Spatial skills is giving us the understanding that how to memorize things. And it has been seen that when we see something on a screen or through some video, it is easy for us to remember. And that is why when you see a movie, you remember it even after some time. So when you actually go through the audio video, it is more impactful, trust me. Because our mind never registers the information in some writings or in some data. It only remembers the pictures. So like right now, we are going through a Zoom session. We can see each other. So we'll remember this picture. This visual clues will further retain with the various information. So your learning, trust me, will be more effective when you are basically going through an online mode, right? So it is going to be, only thing is that the mindset, as Sudipto earlier pointed out, that we were more flown with the traditional pattern. The mindset of the society is that we go for a traditional education, otherwise it is not the right education. So it will take time. The society is not really giving importance, but this is a time when we have to break this conventional thought. And it is time for us to accept the new innovations, right? And
that can I add something on this question? Please, because please. I think, Reed, the thing is that sometimes when I was also prepared for my GATE exam and other things was there. So I usually do write into the chart paper. Okay. So you can use different color paints. Okay. So in different color, you can easily able to remember the thing. So you just do a chart paper in front of you. And you used to do in a schedule, as sir has told, na, that you have to maintain some schedule. So you maintain it. And accordingly, you use the different color. And when you wake up in the morning, you just see the things and recapitulate the things. I think that would be helpful for your concentration as well.
And parents also, you please make sure that create a wake up and sleeping schedule. Because in many homes, right now due to the pandemic, we are not sleeping on time and not getting up on time. So in the waking up and like going to the bed should be also a schedule. So like I think your mom is also watching. So
my mother wished to ask something.
Yeah, please.
My mother wished to ask.
Yes, madam.
She is English teacher. Yeah. My mother is 68 years old. She's English teacher.
Please go ahead.
Mommy, please ask.
Sir, good afternoon. I have a question. Sir, I have been teaching last 40 years. Yes, it is, obviously it is a big change for us to teach online classes.
True.
It is a big change for us. I am trying my best, but tell me some tips how to make impressive, how to convince a student, how to convince your parents. Tell me some tips, sir.
Sure. The first thing which I would like to share, madam, is like I'm so grateful that you have come to our show. First of all, I welcome to our show. In fact, with the time, what we need to understand that, first of all, we have to be acceptable to audience. So when we are talking to the audience who are basically virtually, because physically and virtually, these two things are different. Speaking to a physical audience and speaking to a virtual audience are completely two different experiences. And today, it's not only for you, but even the young age teachers are equally facing the same challenge. The acceptance of their classes are really not coming up to the mark. And that is why in many cases, the experience is very poor. So in order to make it acceptable, there are a few things we have to learn. Number one, we have to understand that when we are coming for a visual classes, we have to talk about the creating a structured pattern. Like right now, you can see that there is a background behind me. Can you see a background behind me? It is very soothing. You can see this.
Yeah.
Right? You can see a
screen.
In fact, I'm sitting in my home. Okay. But you have to learn slowly that how to use the technology to make it more soothing. So you need proper students who can give you a proper pattern, a proper background, which is very important. Secondly, you have to understand that when we are talking to the audience, we have to understand that the way we are giving our deliberation or lecture is not same as the physical classes. So we should know that how exactly we should take regular interval of pauses, taking agreement of the students, and at the same time, being more realistic and participative in our style. Because normally, most of the teachers are already trained or they are more familiar in giving classroom sessions. But due to this virtual training process, we have to be more collaborative approach. So instead of only giving lectures, we also have to give them sometimes some activities and some kind of visual clue, which could be shared with some slideshow, which could be some kind of PowerPoint presentation. Maybe you can take help of Ankur, or maybe you can take help of somebody. Right? So they can always guide you further that how exactly to mix and match your activity with different kind of things. Because the days have now changed. Today, when we talk about virtual classroom have to be more interactive. And when it is more interactive, it will be easier for you to get the feedback. So after everything you come out, we should always try to take a feedback.
Right. Okay. She was only concerned about the feedback that children are reciprocating or not, because since last 40 years, she's teaching in very interactive way.
Yeah.
She's very concerned whether students are getting her deliberation or not.
Yeah, so that is definitely a very important question.
Mommy, correct me if I'm wrong.
No, absolutely.
Yes, you are right.
I think we should really think of how we can go for this transition from a physical classroom to a virtual classroom. I will ask Mohana, who is quite, she's also a student. Mohana, what exactly are your experiences on this? Since you are taking
one
question, what exactly are your views?
My views, actually my experience is a good one. What I've been facing is like this online classes which we are generally having. It's actually, you know, we can extract the main thing out of it. Whereas in physical classes, normally we used to have different kinds of distractions, like the person sitting beside me used to poke me, or sometime she might be like, asking me something, maybe which is just out of the discussion. So those kind of disturbances or maybe those distractions are not here. And one more thing is like, from my part, I should be fair enough. Not from only my part, from like every student should be fair enough. Like when our teacher is giving some assignments, we should do it honestly. There should not be any sort of dishonesty. Like last week only we had our geography test where actually there was a, like ma'am gave us 10 questions and we were about to write the answers and we were marked accordingly. So when she gave us that, you know, a few people were honest and like 60% were honest, whereas 40% were like, you know, dishonest, like not listening to the teacher and just copying from the book and just giving the answers and getting full marks. Now that will only hamper yourself only, and it's like of no good to you, right? So we must be fair enough and we should be honest.
Okay.
And we must concentrate, like it will be for our own good only.
Okay. So that's a question of integrity. Thank you, Mohana. So that's also a very important point, that how much we are honest in this online education. That is also a very important point. So
very valid point. Very valid point.
Yes. So I think since the students as well as the teacher both have to be honest in this process. So we have to see that the students are also remaining trustworthy and the teachers also, we can rely on them as they're always guiding us. So I think as Madam has already rightly said, that this transition, how to get the feedback, at the same time students should be honest in giving the feedback, that really it is comprehensive for them, they're understanding it or not. I would like to from a mother, Madam God, if you can say something.
Yes, she's coming in a short while. Unfortunately, there is a call on a very urgent call.
Okay,
she's coming in a short while.
So as a father, what exactly are the challenges you are facing, Mr. Ankur? If you can
Sir, I'm trying to cope up with the situation, because I just want to give the best to my daughter as far as the facility is concerned. We have applied that giga fiber in our home. Smartphone has been taken. Try to give the conducive environment for studies and all. We try to make silence during her classes and all. Try her mother, you know, help her to summarize the things with a piece of paper and all. Mm-hmm. My mother is also conducting English classes. So my daughter is also a student of my mother from Kota. I'm in Jaipur. So we are trying to give best of the environment for my daughter to get good education on, you know.
Right.
By that she can score good marks.
So what exactly are you doing to ensure that she is going for this kind of new change? Are you fixing any regime for her? Are you basically keeping any kind of schedule that this is the time when she should get up? Yeah. This is the time when she should go for the online classes? And what exactly the challenges you are facing as parents? Yes, madam.
Sir, I'm thankful to my wife because she has prepared a schedule for my daughter. This time you need to wake up, this time you have to sleep, this is the time, this is the play time. Okay. This is the time for you. Everything has been, not only study, this is your TV time, this is your play time, this is your physical activity time. Wonderful. I am fortunate enough that my mother is also guiding from Kota itself to my daughter all the time for her daily schedule for her studies and all.
So this is very important. This is very important. Giving them the kind of support at this hour is very important because mentally we all have to be ready with this change because this has come all of a sudden and many of us are not really prepared to take on this change which has come in our lifestyle. Right? Sanjit, what exactly is your point of view for this online education when we talk about for the grown-up people, those who are in college, those who are professional studies, like you are a professor.
Yes.
So what is your point of view on that? How exactly you see this change?
Yes, no, as I told earlier also that online education for the grown-up students is quite perfect because they are quite matured and they also know that how to conduct themselves in the classroom, all these things. And as far as I concerned, as far as I think that for them it is quite good. And as others, members also pointed out that for the children, it might not be okay because there would be a certain kind of uncertainty for them. They are not mixing with the classmates or they are not getting some physical activity. And right now what is happening with my boy also, with my kid also, he is staying all the time at home. He is 7 years old. And this is my biggest concern is that he is staying at home only, no physical activity, he is studying for 2-3 hours. And except that what is happening, watching TV and playing video games, so this is the biggest problem for the kids. But for the grown-ups, I think this online education could be quite good because the education from anywhere in the world.
I have a solution for you, Mr. Sanjit. Since you rightly said that is a concern for the small ones or the younger kids, you have to maintain, as I said, that you have to create a timetable for them. So in that timetable, you have to keep some time for physical exercise also, which could be indoor exercises, could be yoga, which could be doing pranayam. Mm-hmm. Maybe 15 minutes of yoga per day is important. So maybe during the breaks, maybe you can start the day with some kind of physical exercise. Keep some type of, maybe indoor games if possible. Because right now you also have to give time. So at least make a point that all of you in the family can find a quality time when you can do yoga together. You can do some freehand exercises. Maybe you can do some freehand aerobics. Mm-hmm. So such exercises have to be done because you see, we all have to be master of our own destiny nowadays. If you really do not take initiative, if I do not take care of my health, if I do not take food, if I do not build up my immunity, if I do not take protection, then nobody can save me today. So we all have to be master of our own destiny. And so you have to give the same timetable to your younger ones at home. Do you understand me? So we all have to take this as a call.
Yes, exactly.
This is the current need of the session. I would ask Mr. Mukesh. Mr. Mukesh, Prabhuji,
yes.
That since you are a self-manager, how exactly you find the training is going on right now and what is the importance of the sales training? And how exactly the training can be given or maybe this online education is effective to manage your team members during this pandemic?
Of course, this in pandemic, it is a very critical challenge we are facing is for the internet connectivity around the world. It is a lot of loads are there on the internet. So that is the one of the major challenge. But at the same time, this is the only way we can connect to our all the, members, the team members and all the, employees of our organizations. And this is the real time to educate them regarding the, most important things. How to do this. Of course, this is a very major, transition from traditional to, different technology. So So of course we are planning and we are doing, and some places it is doing very well, extraordinary, because earlier it was very difficult to connect the customers at the same time, more than expected numbers. But here nowadays we can connect more than 10,000 customers at the same time on this online platform. So at the same time, you know, we can say this is best also. And sometime, you know, when we are not connectivity, there's no proper connectivity, then it is, you know, a slight challenge. So this is for the sales professionals, but for the general life and especially for their students, this is only the way by which they can understand and they can continue their study.
Okay.
This is going definitely to go to
the heart of the student. Thank you, Mr. Mukesh. Thank you. Sudipta, what exactly your point of view about this online education in the professional world? How have you planned? You were recently telling me that you have registered for some online courses. So what is that online education you are pursuing right now? If you can give your experience on that.
Yeah, actually, there are a few courses which is conducted by Google, at least, Google Analytics, if you see, like a lot of digital marketing courses are available. It's a free of cost. And even in LinkedIn, you will also get a few of the courses. So there are different modules. So which will help you out to understand how the market is moving and how you can enlighten yourself into the.
So are you currently pursuing any such online courses?
No, right now I'm not doing anything.
Okay.
I have done a course in LinkedIn earlier.
Okay. Fine.
So it has been.
Please carry on.
In Google, there is 72 module is over there. So if someone is interested, so he can entitle and he or she can do herself or himself.
It has been seen through the research that this online education is definitely catching up in the present trend, and day by day, large number of people are really participating in this online education. And the biggest part is, like in India also, there are many companies like Byju's, a Bangalore-based company who is very famous in the virtual classes. Okay, Tencent Cloud, right? And many such companies are coming up who are basically opening up these mediums. Even in Cambridge University, they have also started online education for the IGCSE board. So I think we have to slowly, but this is also an opportunity for many, you know, the professionals, that it is time for you to develop your online skills. Because, you know, there are days when people are talking about physical interview. Maybe now we will have virtual interviews. Okay. Similarly, we'll have virtual presentation, virtual examination, virtual assessment, virtual submission of your project. So this online education is definitely going to stay even after the pandemic because of its effectiveness. And because you see, the cost is also minimized to a larger extent. Because earlier, if you are traveling to one city, you have to pay a lot of cost in traveling, lot of exhaustion. But now if it is virtually possible, I think that is the most interesting part. And the things can happen more faster. Mr. Ankur, I think you want to make some point.
Same, I was, you know, I have also enrolled myself for French classes and few soft skill classes. So I am 100% agree with you. The way things are proceeding, the way things are going on, we should be very acquainted with the online education system, because coming time now, you need to be, everything will be online, most of the things. Like you have rightly quoted for the interview also. So we need to acclimatize ourselves in a way by that we can be very familiar. As Tiwari sir has also mentioned one for my daughter, for concentration and all. So somehow you need to be very, train your mind in a way by that you can gain maximum knowledge from online.
Okay. Thank you so much. And I believe like we have contributed some good points today. We have basically understood that how exactly the parents should play their role in engaging their kids. And we have to understand that how much they are concentrating and focused in their online education and not doing any other internet activity. Number two, how you're building a structured environment for them. Number three, how you can help in like making a timetable for them. And number four is like making a work and household activity balance, because that can sometimes affect your students also. And of course, helping them in doing some physical exercises, because maybe some kind of pranayam, yoga, some physical exercises, some mind games will give them some kind of, you know, positive, result. So if you are still finding it difficult, I think it's time for you to work it out and prepare students. Especially, you prioritize your goals, make a weight analysis so that you basically understand that what is the most essential thing for you to do and not just getting distracted by any other thing. And especially if you have siblings, the brothers and sisters, so you also try to lock yourself sometime in some room. Otherwise, your younger ones will come and disturb you during your classes. So you may have such challenges. We have to, like, brothers and sisters. So if such challenges are there, you know how to handle it. So I'm sure, like, and Madam Sharma has already said that what exactly we need to do, like she rightly asked that taking feedback for a teacher, from a teacher's point of view, I will also say that you have to gradually accept the transition and understand that we have to overcome the classroom technique and think more of the visual clue, think more of virtually exchanging the thoughts, maybe virtual classroom, how we can be more interactive. All these areas we have to improve. So it is time for us not thinking that what we have to prove, but we have to improve ourselves. Gradually, day by day, when we improve, because you see, I'm also continuously learning, because I was also not familiar with the virtual sessions and all. So gradually now I'm getting comfortable interacting and giving deliberations through online forums. So I think these are the new changes the world is going to see. So I think my audience will agree the same on this. So please prepare yourself for the online classes. The online education is going to stay even after the COVID is over. So with this, we believe that online education is going to stay because the retention of education is much better. And maybe after the pandemic, we will see it more seriously and we'll try to give input. Right? So Sudipta, we will no more have comment that online education is not important. So it will be equally given importance.
It is important. Equally important. Right, sir, right. I have a question.
Please, madam.
10% parents are not educated.
Yes.
It is very difficult for us to convince to ask their children to take online classes. Anna?
Yes.
Due to illiteracy.
True.
There is one problem.
Madam, I just want to quickly give answer to this question that 60% population is online today, and it is a big challenge for the mankind, for the government to cope up, because the government is slowly coming up in places like in Rajasthan, in West Bengal, in Bihar. They're coming up with some television classes. At the same time, sensitization has to take place so that people can tell people more about the importance of online education. For example, with the COVID now, you see, many people are not even able to go to their offices or to their workplaces. So in this situation, unless and until they realize this importance, we cannot survive. The education, which is an important thing, cannot stop. Same like healthcare. Or we cannot say that we will wait for the schools to open. So it is high time for us to understand the way we have accepted smartphone, because there was a time when people did not believe on mobile phone. But now people are believing on mobile phone. They are doing everything on mobile phone. So in the same way, we have to also accept this as a reality. Isn't it? So slowly, even you see, even in the remote village, people know what is a smartphone and they know they can do a lot of entertainment through smartphone. In the same way, they have to understand the smartphone can be used for education for their kids, which can bring a brighter prospect for their children. Because education is a bridge between the have and the have nots. So if they want to give a better future to their country and to the individual, then education cannot be ignored. And with the coming situation, it should be a priority and it has to be accepted. Right? Thank you all of you for being part of this wonderful session. It was really a lot of learning we got together, and hope
to see
you again for the next session. And I believe we'll be like meeting for one more interactive topic like this way. And please be with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir.
Enjoy your weekend. Take care.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you. Thank you all.